So I was talking about the D2C as a journey, right? So D2C is it's primarily for everyone, whoever wants to get started on this journey. The key area of focus here is what does it takes to be a good consultant, right? We focus on four different areas: understanding the business domain, what your customer is doing, what your end users are using as an application, how the entire business is running, different products within the Salesforce ecosystem, how they basically map to solve a business problem, how technically competent you are as a professional, and how can you recommend solutions based on your knowledge, based on your business understanding, how you can map technology and the business requirements together, and how you can articulate your solutions well. So these are four traits which I have observed in a successful consultant over the years. And today in this session, we are going to focus on the communication aspect of a consultant, where how you can better represent yourself, whether it is through email or whether it is through phone conversations, how you can bring the best out of yourself is what we are going to focus on. So in a nutshell, what is consulting all about? To me, consulting is not about the titles that we get in our companies. You might be a functional consultant, you might be a technical consultant, or someone would call them as a techno-functional consultants as well. But really, if you deep dive into the concept of consulting, it's all about asking the right questions, listening out to your business stakeholders on their problem statement, and expressing yourself wherein you are able to communicate fluently with your business counterparts in the business language, with your technical teams or your development teams in the technical language. If you are a person who can do that well, you have the Salesforce knowledge, you can apply that knowledge to solve real world business problems, and you can communicate well with both the business as well as the technical teams, you are there with that mindset, which I call it as a consulting mindset. And D2C's core aspect is how we can develop this consulting mindset through our professional journey and how we can get into the consulting world. So that's all about the D2C at its core, what it focuses on. And today we are going to talk about one of the pillars of what D2C stands for is communication. And we'll deep dive into the workshop from here on. So with that, I'll introduce myself for people who don't know me. I'm Rupesh Bhatia. I'm Salesforce MVP since 2019. Solution architect with one of the global consulting leaders across the world, and have been into the Salesforce ecosystem since 2010. So we'll be completing 10 years very soon this year. I would like to invite Sebastian Wagner as a co-speaker today. And Sebastian is a CTA himself, as Om mentioned. Sebastian, welcome to the meetup.
And similar to Rupesh, I started my journey in 2006. So 14 years ago, and has been quite a ride. And what I have experienced in those last couple of years is really the importance of communication, which is why Rupesh and me have teamed up to kind of bring you guys a little bit more insights of how can you be more impactful in the way you're communicating, how can you really get your points across, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really something that is very close and dear to my heart, and which is why I'm here today. I also have a very close personal relationship with Biha. I tend to come to Bulgaria every year for the teachings of the Dalai Lama. I've also come to Bulgaria to do my 10-day Vipassana retreat 2 years ago. Sadly, this year, I hadn't had a chance yet to come back. So I'm really happy to at least attend virtually. And I'm pleased to meet you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And we are very honored to have you on this meetup. So you were very moderate in introducing yourself. But just to give you a background to everyone on the meetup here, Sebastian is one of the CTAs, early CTAs. I think you became a CTA in 2016, Sebastian, if I'm not wrong. And
2014. 2014, so it's 6 years tenure.
Oh, yeah. He was one of the early CTAs back then. And as you all know, in the ecosystem, there are not many CTAs out there, right? He also runs his own company where he provides coaching services on for aspirant CTAs across the globe. So that's more about him. I just wanted the audience to know about you more.
Thank you.
Yeah, and he has a Bihar connection as well. So definitely next time when Seb is in Bihar for his Vipassana, or we should definitely get hold of him and invite him in person for a Motihari meetup.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you. And moving on to the workshop, you guys can unmute yourself, and throughout the session, if you want to add any of your experiences or if you have any queries, we'll have a dedicated Q&A session at the end of the meetup. But if you want to chime in with any of the examples, if you relate to a point, right, and if you want to share it with the larger audience, feel free to do so. We'll make this as an interactive. And so the next slide here is forms of communication. Can any one of you unmute yourself and describe what are the different forms of communication that comes to your mind?
Yeah, one is the written communication, and other comes in mind is the verbal communication.
Yes, these are very basic forms of communication which we interact on a day-to-day basis in our offices, at home, with friends, everywhere, right? Verbal and written communication. Anything else when it comes to communication?
Yes, I guess body language also comes as a part of communication.
Body language, right? So people who are specially able cannot communicate through voice, so they have body language or sign languages to communicate as well. Body language, yes, again, it's an important attribute. You might not talk, but you can express a lot with your body language as well. When you are in a meeting with leadership, with project teams, or even having a one-on-one conversation, language, we have sign language as another means of communication as well, not just verbal or not just email, right? So we'll first, so there are two sections for this entire workshop. One is email writing. We'll focus more on business email writing, not personal emails. And the second part of it is more about how do you handle verbal communication in your office setup? How do you manage your scrum calls? How do you go into a leadership meeting? And what are the different areas that you need to look into? So starting off with email communication, first and foremost, whenever you start writing an email, these are some of the clear guidelines that you need to keep in mind while constructing an email or while drafting your email. First and foremost is having a clear and a descriptive subject line. Now, each one of us get lots of email that comes to us for promotions, right? On our Gmail accounts or on our even in your office setup, you get a lot of emails during your day, right? Now, the subject, based on the subject, you will decide whether you want to open up that event, open up that email or not, right? If the email is not descriptive enough, and if you find it as fishy, you will never open that email, right? So whenever you are sending an email out to anyone, ensure that the subject line is very clear. The intent of the messaging of your email should be coming out very clearly in your subject line itself. The from address, now this is not an issue for if you are sending an email within office from your office email address, but if anyone would have worked in a marketing cloud setup or in any of the marketing projects, typically when you send out emails from any from address, it might end up in a junk folder or spam folders of the recipients, right? And that typically happens because your from address is not a trusted email address on the recipient's mail servers. So that's where ensuring that whenever you are corresponding with anyone who is outside your office, ensuring that you are sending out an email from your office email address and not your personal email address would ensure that your emails have been received well by the external participants as well. The next point is around signatures. I've seen this often ignored by most of the people within an office setup. We don't really give much importance to how the signature should look like. And when I say signature, anything which comes after your name, where you mention thanks and regards, Rupesh Bhatia. And I have an example of my signature, which I use normally based on my firm's guidelines. Every company has their own guidelines around how the signature should look like. Follow your company's guidelines and set up your signature template in the office settings or whichever mailbox you're using, if it's Gmail or Outlook. Based on those guidelines, apply the signature in all of your outgoing emails, whether you're replying to someone or whether you're forwarding an email or drafting a new email, right? Always ensure you have a meaningful signature where your company name, your title, your business line, your phone numbers, your email ID is very clearly written over there. And often it also represents a brand about your company. So there will be branding guidelines as well as to what colors you can adopt to your signature lines as well. So ensure you reach out to your office admins and if it's a bigger organization, normally you don't have a person whom you can reach out directly. What we normally end up doing is follow our leadership. If any of the leader has a set signature, just copy paste and tailor it for your own self. Ensure you have your own designation. Do not copy designation of your leaders. Ensure you are mentioning your own email ID. Do not mention email IDs of someone else and your own phone numbers as well. So that's one area which needs to be looked out. Be mindful of whom are you addressing in your email. Who is in your to address versus who is in a CC, who is in BCC versus reply all, right? Now, why this is important? When you're writing one-on-one emails, it's fine. You are always addressing to one person. But when you're writing an email to a team, right, you have to be mindful of who is in the to bracket versus who is in the CC bracket, right? Typically, all the leaders end up in the CC bracket. CC means that you're basically copying a person on that email just for their information, and the actual intent of the message is for someone who is in the to addresses, okay? So do not jumble up on that. Normally, these are very small things, but we tend to ignore these small nuances around our day-to-day working, right? And it's often the simplest of the things that we should focus on so that we can set ourselves apart from our rest of our peers, right? So if there are 100 people working in a team or in a company, how do you differentiate yourself, right, as a good communicator? This is how you can differentiate yourself, by addressing these small things and being laser focused on how do you communicate. Okay. Be mindful of reply all. When I say reply all, this typically happens when, let's say, leadership has broadcasted a practice-wide message to all the Salesforce employees, and you have a viewpoint which you want to share with the entire audience, right? And you do a reply all, and then in next 1 hour, you'll find all 100 people have responded to using the reply all option, and you would have had 100 emails in your mailbox, right? Now, imagine this happening for a practice which is 2,000 people wide or 5,000 people wide, right? Everybody's mailboxes will just be cluttered and clogged by lots and lots of emails in next 1 hour or 2 hours, right? And what happens in this entire scenario is, often people would tend to miss any of their important emails which they would be expecting for their work, right? So restrict your reply all options unless it is really required for you to do a reply all and where you want to share your thoughts with everybody in the audience, right? Most of the times, like 80%, you don't even know who the audience is if you are replying all to a message which was broadcasted by the leadership, right? Typical examples here are, I can share, is your last working day emails, right? Where we tend to send to all our friends, project teams, past project teams, if you have worked in a company, let's say for 5 hours, all of my project teams, all my friends, all my managers, all my leaders, I'll tend to keep everyone in that loop, informing them that today is my last day. And then people will just start replying all one after the other and clogging up emails or mailboxes for each and everyone who is there in that email chain. So avoid that. That's not recommended. If you want to reply to someone, if someone is leaving or somebody is celebrating an occasion, reply them on one-on-one and give your best wishes. With that, let's look into whenever you're drafting your email, the middle section, which is the actual content that you put in your email, right? Always read your email before hitting that send button. Now, I emphasize on this more because I've seen most of the times when you are responding to an email in a hurry or with in a quest to respond it in the best possible time, you tend to overlook some of your spell checks, some of your grammar, and at times even the facts that you want to convey are being misinterpreted, right? You should take at least 2 minutes to read through your email, understand what is that intent of that email, who is in your audience, which is the to address, the CC address and the BCC, and whether that email is conveying the thought that you wanted to convey in first place, right? Now, scenarios, if I can list out from my experiences, if somebody has not agreed to you on your viewpoint, on a requirement, or somebody has written something in a complaining manner about you to someone, right? We tend to reply in agitation, being aggressive, that how can somebody complain about me, or how can somebody say something about me, right? In an office setup, such kind of emails should be read at least thrice before you hit the send button, before you respond to anyone who is in a complaint or in a escalation mode. So somebody, if the project is having a scenario which is under an escalation, do not reply your escalation emails without reading your emails thrice, so that you cool off your mind, ensure that whatever facts you are representing in your email body is valid, is supported by all the data points, all your messaging is right up there before you hit the send button. And I cannot emphasize enough why this is so important when you are dealing with situations like escalations on project, situations like where somebody has complained against you, right? These are some of the scenarios where you need to be extra careful before hitting out the send. Use punctuations appropriately, right? And I'll give you an example on one of my emails which I had written way back in 2009. Before I entered into the Salesforce ecosystem, how punctuations are important and why your email messaging should be appropriate. Do not disclose confidential information, right? And since COVID-19 has happened, we are all working remotely, right? We are all working in virtual scenarios, virtual meetings are happening. Everybody is working from home, right? There's a lot of client data which resides on your laptops, your machines. Avoid anything which should not be there on your email going out to external audience. Avoid any confidential information to be added in your mail bodies. Okay. You might have your project specific information. You might have your client specific information when you're dealing with data migration, integration scenarios, right? Do not ever attach any Excel sheet if it is intended to be shared. Always share it using a shared repository and provide a link only to the recipients who are supposed to receive it, right? Do not accidentally also, even if your intentions are correct, there might be scenarios where your company or you as an individual can end up in a problematic scenario. So always be careful of disclosing any confidential information in your emails. Whenever you get an email from your colleagues or your leaders or your immediate leads, right? Have this good habit of responding them in time, right? ideally, there are no service level agreements in terms of email response time, but it's a good practice to respond within a day. If not, then within 2 days maximum. Let's say if you're on a holiday and you cannot respond back to your email, right? It's a good practice that as soon as you come back from your holidays, you will respond back to them, right? And we'll cover why out of office notifications are also important. If in case you are not available in office, if you are busy in full day trainings, why out of office emailers becomes very important in communicating that you are not available for that day and you will respond back to your emails once you are back in office or once you are back to your day-to-day activities within a project. And if you're writing to someone who don't know you, right? So today when I started off this session, I started off by introducing myself, right? So similarly, in an email conversation, if somebody has never worked with you, if someone have never met you in person, it's a good practice to always introduce yourself. When I say introduction, don't talk about your previous companies or your previous projects. Talk about what is your current role in the project and in what capacity you are writing that email for, right? So give a brief context about yourself. Why are you addressing that person and what is your intent of reaching out to that person? Because you have never met, you have never interacted, this is the first time. Let the person know about yourself a bit, what role you are playing on that project. Be mindful of what you're discussing on your email messaging, right? Anything which is still in pilot phase or beta phase, do not put it out on email, because once an email is sent from your mailbox, it is out there in public. Anyone who is receiving that email, you never know that emails might get forwarded to some third person, to some fourth person whom you are not even aware of, right? So always keep your content within an email restricted to information which is out there in public domain. If you are working in a product company, let's say, for example, you have seen any of Salesforce presentations, the first slide that comes up is forward-looking statement, right? They make it very clear that whatever they are communicating through their slides should not be taken into consideration while making buying decisions or purchasing decisions, right? Why do they do that? Because they might be announcing or discussing some things which is still in beta phase, which is still in pilot phase, which is still not out there for public consumption. And if you put it out there, you have to make that disclaimer that do not use it because it is not available in public yet, right? Similarly, for your emails, whenever you're discussing any confidential matter which is not out there in public, always be mindful of that. The next point, I've faced this primarily with freshers or junior team members who have this habit of writing out emails on each and every small instances, right? So you have to be judicious enough or matured enough as a professional to understand when to write emails versus when to have one-on-one conversations. If there is, a disagreement between the team, right, with the team member with whom you are working on a day-to-day basis, it's better off that you have a one-on-one conversation and clear off your differences, whether it is about technical areas, whether it is non-technical areas. At times, what we end up doing is we write emails copying managers, team leads, everyone in loop, and then just one person is responding to each other, and it's a long email chain that gets created without any fuss about it, right? And always be mindful that whatever emails you're writing, you are creating a impression about yourself, who you are as a person, right? It represents you, it is documented, and it can be used against you once things are not good between the project team or between the onshore offshore or between you and your client, right? So be mindful that whatever you're typing in, it's documented and it will represent you, and it can be used as a matter of proof if there are any escalation or any difficult scenarios to handle. When you're writing your emails, be very clear in your messaging, and we'll show some examples on why am I stressing on this. Having a clear and to the point messaging helps in ensuring that people who are supposed to read that email are reading your emails and not ignoring you. Again, as I said, understanding whom are you writing to, who is in CC, who is in BCC, so that you can tailor your messaging in your emails accordingly. Some housekeeping items around the email writing. Avoid one-liners. So this typically happens in your day-to-day project scenarios where you know each other so well that you stop addressing them that hi Om, right? I'll just reply him saying that this is the task and this is what you need to do, right? Instead of properly drafting that email saying hi Om, this is what we had discussed, these are the follow-up action items, thank you Rupesh Bhatia, right? That's a nicely drafted email versus just shooting out one-liners. Now, it might be okay in some scenarios, but that's typically not ideal. You lose your professionalism at some point in time if you develop that as a habit, and you never know when you are interacting with external audience, you might send out them one-liners as well, right? So avoid that and always ensure that you're following professionalism in your email writing, even if it is within the team, right? That practice makes man perfect. That perfectly sits over your practice, whatever you want to do in your day-to-day life, in your email communication daily, so that you get better at it on a day-to-day basis. Next is out of office, as I said, right? If you are busy in trainings, if you are doing stuff which is outside your project, if you are on holidays, if you have taken personal time off, if you are sick, right? Always ensure that you have enabled or your out of office email notification, so that any person who is trying to reach out to you, if there is something urgent, something critical, right? They will understand that you are not available now and you will respond back once you have resumed your office, right? This is something which I have seen mostly among the junior team members, that if they are going on leave or if they are sick, they will just WhatsApp their team leads or their managers stating that I won't be available today because I'm sick, right? Now one can understand that if you're sick, you cannot get time to log in and set your out of office emails. But then if you're going on a planned PO, always ensure that you are setting up that out of office notification so that people around you are notified when they try to reach out to you. Avoid slang language or short words. For example, anytime, right? Avoid using NY time. The kind of short forms that we use on Skype discussions or Google chats or WhatsApp, right? Avoid those kind of slangs in your office emails. And I'll give you a perfect example where I had used them a lot. And we'll look at it once we get there. Keep your messaging very clean and clear and do not share any large attachments. If there is a document which you need to share, and if it is 5 MB, 10 MB or 15 MB, yes, Office Outlook supports those kind of sizes today, but then always best practice is to upload it in a shared repository and share the link so that you are not clogging up email boxes of the recipients, because whenever you download your email in your mailbox, it tries to download your attachment as well, right? So it takes up space. The best practice is always to share it with a link and not the actual document whenever you are sharing it to your external participants. With that, let me give you a scenario, and I'll give you time to read through this email, okay? So the scenario is Rupesh Bhatia back in 2009, when I was looking out for a job. I was a .NET developer back then, and I was working in a very small company of hardly 50 odd people, right? And I was looking out for a job, primarily looking to change my technology, because I had realized that there is a lot of competition out here in India as far as .NET development is concerned. So I started looking out, and I got a job offer from one of the company which was offering me a BI profile. BI is business intelligence, and the tool that I was asked to work on was Qlik View. And at that point in time, I had to take that decision of whether I want to move into a new technology or whether I want to continue as a .NET developer and explore more technically around development than focusing on a BI tool, right? Now, I started my career in 2006. 2009, this scenario happened. I was just 3 years experienced professional, not very good in communication because all my initial years were with small companies, very small startups. Nobody really gave me any good lessons around email writing. This is what I end up writing. All of you, I'll give you 2 minutes to go through this email, and then I'll discuss what are the good things about this email and then what are the bad things about this email. Okay, so having this context will help you understand whatever I have written over here and why I have written these things. Okay, I'll again interrupt in next 2 minutes. I'll give you the time. So it's very clear, right? I basically declined the offer to the HR, and I basically put in my thought process. Why am I declining it, right? If you compare it with today's scenario, if you have to decline an offer, will you write such an elaborate email? Probably no. Probably you'll say that thanks for the offer and I would not like to pursue it ahead, and we'll be in touch, right? Basically two liners stating that I'm not interested and I've selected something else for myself. And yeah, that's pretty much right. Now, first I'll focus on what are the things which are totally bad in this email, right? I cannot imagine myself writing all this. Very bad English, slangs or short forms used everywhere, right? For example, just to highlight, should, it's not a full word. I've written as if I'm writing someone to, you know, in a WhatsApp chat. Cause, because, instead of because, I've written cause. Anytime I've written a short form again, right? Continuation of my thoughts is basically denoted by these four dots throughout the email, right? If you would have seen. But even though this is such a badly written email, right? The good part of this email to me at least was I have clearly written whatever is going on in my mind. Someone reading through this will clearly understand why I had taken that decision, what is there which is going in my mind, and why am I declining this offer, right? And why there was a need for me to make this so much elaborative. I wanted the leadership, because typically what happens is when you decline an offer, the email sits with the HR and that's it. It doesn't go out to the leadership who wanted to hire me. They will never know why I declined that offer. So I had made a request that please forward this to your management so that they can have a clear picture of why I have taken this decision. And you would not imagine, when I sent out this email back in 2009, the CEO of the company was in Singapore. And I was enjoying my break between my two jobs. I was out there somewhere in Gujarat, and the CEO calls up me and says that I want you to reconsider your position or your decision about joining us, because I really want you in my team. And that was very surprising for someone who is a 3-year experienced guy who have just declined an offer to get a call from the CEO directly. Although it was a small company, not that big, but it was fairly big for a CEO to call up someone who has just declined their position, right? So the intent here is, if you are clearly articulating your thought process, even though the English could have been better, even though the language could have been proper or the grammar mistakes could have been less, right? If today I have to write the same mail, I would have written like half the size of it with clear sentences, with the same thought process, but in a much more better English than in 2009. This is one of my personal emails which I keep referring to. I go back to it because it gives me a lot of positive vibes that even back then, I had that clear thought process where I can put my thoughts into an email, right? So with that, let's look at some of the sample scenarios that you can also think through. How will you write those emails? And then I'll show you how I would attempt those emails into 2020. Right? So let's look at the four scenarios. First is job application with your CV. So if you're applying for your new job and you would have heard about that job from LinkedIn or through your friend, right? And if you want to apply it to the HR, how would you do that? Second is around leave note to your team lead. If you want a leave and you cannot make it to the office and you want to inform your team lead, how will you do that? Minutes of meeting, MOM, as we call it in a short form, of your daily meetings, if you have done a daily stand-up, how many of you really write MOMs and circulate it back to your team? It is done by one of the team members. Can you take that responsibility of writing an MOM or not? Pushing back on a requirement to your onshore counterparts or to your client directly, if you are not agreeing to a technical solution or if you think that there is a better approach to it, do you voice yourself through an email that there is a better option available, and why do you suggest that there is the option which you are suggesting is a better one than the one which is currently being discussed, right? So I'll give you 2 minutes to think through how will you write these emails, and then I'll walk you through how would I have written these emails, right? So that you can get a glimpse of how things, where exactly my thought process and your thought process is differing and how we can align. So I'll let you guys think through all the 4 scenarios in 2 minutes and I'll be back.
Yeah, Asmit here. There's a question I wanted to ask related to scenario 4.
Yep.
So there's always a conflict between a developer suggesting a solution and a technical architect who might be or might not be someone who is very updated. So how should we tackle with that? I mean, there are always points which a developer tries to push it, but there are always points which a technical architect or solution architect tries to revert it back. So
very good question. Very good question, Asmit, and I love this. I'll answer to your question once we cover all 4 scenarios, and some of these has been answered in the draft email that I have written. So I'll address it once we are at the scenario 4.
All right.
Anyone needs more time? Are we good to move on?
Yeah, we can move on.
Okay. Let's look at the first scenario. Okay. I've written the subject, I've written the mail body, and I've provided my signature as well. It's a very generic signature. The mobile number is a fake one. Don't try calling me on this mobile number. So basically, in short, I've given the reference from where I've got this job information, and I've mentioned my intent of applying for it. I've given my CV for the perusal, and I'm available on below coordinates to discuss any next steps. Looking forward to hearing from you. Very short, very to the point, and conveying my message that I'm interested in your job. Now, obviously, you guys might have a better way of representing the same thing, right? Everybody has their own style of our own perspective of writing down things, right? Just to give you a glimpse of what goes on in my mind when I write emails, right? That is where I'm sharing this, right? No email is good or bad. It's just that your thoughts should come out clearly on what you're writing, right? So focus on that and always ensure that your message is clear and crisp, and the intent is coming out very nicely, okay? And notice the subject line as well. I've made it, I've tried to ensure that the HR who would be receiving this email knows my name, knows the title for which I'm applying, and knows the job application number which they had posted on LinkedIn, right? So that these are quick points through which they can relate, okay, why this email has come and why they should look at the attached CV. Okay. Now, typically when you're writing for a job application, you not mention your company name and all of that. But this is more of a corporate or if you're writing business emails, that's where the signature part comes into the play. If I would have writing this from my personal mailbox, I would write more about my title, my role in the company and the kind of certificates I have. Probably I'm a D2C advocate, so I would mention about it, right? Something which describes me as a professional outside my workplace. All right, let's move on to the next one. Leave note to your team lead. Again, here, if you look at the subject, I mentioned it that I'm going to notifying you on my leave from 3rd May till 5th of May for 3 days. And I've addressed it to Om that I'm unable to join the office today because of some family emergency. You can mention your reason as well if it can be shared with your manager or with your team lead. I need to travel out of my town for next 3 days and will resume office and so on so date. And because I'm not available for my project work, I'll give my updates on whatever is the pending task and if it can be assigned to anyone else, right? And all of this is possible if I have time on my hand, right? If there is a real family emergency, I will not even do this, right? I will just go off and I'll probably notify it through offline medium or call up my manager saying that this is what I am into and I need to leave. Please take care of these things. If there's anything needed, I'm available on my phone. But if you have time, if you're going on a planned vacation, ensure that you are giving proper updates before you leave for your vacation so that nobody calls up and disturbs you on your personal time. Clear? Let's move to the next one. MOM. Now, there are different ways in which minutes of meeting can be captured. Some projects might use a nicely crafted a PPT slide, and that goes out as a MOM. Some people can put it in a nicely structured table format to send it out to the audience. I've just used a very simple mechanism over here to draft everything on an email body. So I'm addressing the team and saying, thanks for your time. Please find below minutes of meeting of our discussion today. If you recollect, I had mentioned that do not use short words, but short words like please find below, please find attached, MOM. These are generally used in business emails. So feel free to use them wherever it's applicable. Topics discussed during the meeting, 1, 2, 3. And if there are any action items on any of the topic discussed, list them out. If action item was for a specific individual, tag them at the rate so-and-so, so that the person is aware that these are the areas where I need to work on and be ready for the next meeting. If there are any open queries which needs clarifications, or the team lead needs to go reach out to your onshore and client stakeholders and get clarifications, list those questions out as well. If there are any identified project risks, call them out as well. And if there are any mitigation plan, if let's say we cannot meet the deadline, how do we mitigate it? By adding more team members or by extending the timeline, whatever it is, right? Based on your scenario, you can add those pointers as well. And then I'm basically wrapping it up saying that please let me know if I've missed out on anything or anything needs an update. If I have wrongly stated anything, let me know so that I can correct it, right? And this just a sample, but yeah, go back to your project teams and understand how the daily MOMs are being circulated. And next time, do take an opportunity to write one. It gives a lot of confidence in your communication building exercises that you have circulated an MOM among the team, which has been used by everyone. Next one is the scenario of pushing back on requirements. So the way I would write here is, being a developer, that I've gone through the requirement and I've done my impact analysis. If in my email recipient, if there is anyone who doesn't know the requirement itself, I'll give a brief context about that requirement, brief description. If there is someone in the to list or in the CC list who is not aware of that requirement, if there are all known people, then you can skip the brief description of the requirement section. You can directly go to what's the solution being discussed, what's your analysis, why you think that this is not possible, state it with facts and with data points and with Salesforce documentation, right? Now, Asmit, coming to your question, if there is a disagreement between an architect and a developer, right? At the end of the day, we are talking about a business problem and solution, right? Solution is primarily on Salesforce. So obviously, whichever solution you're proposing, there will be a relative Salesforce documentation available. There will be certain limits, governor limits, or any data point which will be available out there to back up your claim versus backing up an architect's claim. What is not there documented is the business context, which an architect might have better than a developer, because architect might be interacting with the client business as well as the IT stakeholders, which a developer doesn't get an opportunity to, right? But however, if you think that you have the complete context which an architect also have around the business or around the requirement, and still if you feel that your solution is a better one, right, get into a conversation with your architect, asking them why they are feeling that a solution A is better than solution B. Obviously, architect with their own experience over the years, right, will have valid data points or valid justification why a solution A is applicable to this specific business scenario versus a solution B. And a good architect will always take time and explain it to their development team, why their thought process, what are they thinking, what is their thought process, and why they have applied this solution versus another solution. And they will also give you a flavor of, if it was some other scenario, then probably your solution would have fitted better, right? And that is where good team leaders or good architects can play that role of justifying or making their team members understand on why they are going ahead with a specific solution. Yeah, Asmit, do you have a follow-up question?
No, thanks, Rupesh. I got my answer.
Yeah.
We generally have this thing in every organization.
Right. So that's right. And see, it's all about people interaction, right? No two architects, no two people are same, right? So you'll find some really helping architects versus you'll find some architects who are who cannot respond back to you or who cannot give you time to make you understand why their solution was better, right? And we often take it in a negative way, stating that this architect is not giving me time or he's not responding to me, he or she is not responding to me, right? And that is where I always convey in my D2C tour is that empathy approach or empathetic approach. Whenever you're working in a team environment, you should always realize what the other person is going through. Might be an architect is busy with 4 other projects and he or she doesn't have enough time to sit with you and explain you every small thing, right? That is where we expect the development team members to research on the solution on their own and then go into a discussion with all their data points and the facts that they have gone through, whether it is Salesforce documentation or any other project specific documentation. Go with all your analysis, sit on a table and discuss it out, right? Maybe the person is busy today, tomorrow, go back to him or her after a week, after a month, whenever you get time, right? Ensure that you get your thoughts aligned with the architect so that you grow as a professional. It is not for architect to grow, it is for you yourself to grow. In that entire conversation, you will gain something out of it. Coming back to this email, right? So we said why it is technically not feasible, support it with data facts and Salesforce documentation, propose an alternative solution, and what is the business value add? Always relate your thought process to a business context, okay? You can never propose a solution stating that this is a easier way to implement. No. Nobody will buy your thought process. If you say that developing a trigger, I will take 4 hours versus configuring a flow, which I don't know how to do it, so I will have to learn it. I've never worked on it, so it is going to take me a day, so I'll better write a trigger, right? Don't go with that thought process. What is easier for you? Go with a thought process on what makes business sense. Why a particular solution will add more business value for your end customers. When you message your thought process with respect to business, people will listen to you, whether it is your project leadership, whether it is your peers, architects, or even your client, they will listen to you as long as you can relate any of your thoughts with the business context. Always keep that in mind. If there is any impact on the timeline and the cost, right? If you feel that there will be an extended timeline because we are going ahead with a solution, and if there will be additional time required, and because there is additional time required, there will be additional cost to the project. All of that you can state if you have relative data points. And if you want a follow-up conversation, ask for it and attach any documentation. So when you're proposing a solution, I normally advise that you build a small document around it, whether it is a PPT or a Word document, right? Clearly describing your solution so that in the next conversation, it is easier for everyone to align on that solution and discuss any pros and cons around it. It is a best practice that you forward that document well in advance for your next meeting so that people, when they come to the meeting, have gone through your document, they understand what you're trying to convey, and the discussion itself is a productive discussion rather than spending 20 minutes just describing what the solution is, right? Instead, you can utilize your first 20 minutes itself discussing the pros and cons and putting forward your viewpoint. So with that, I'll move on to assignments. We have three scenarios listed over here, okay? And this is for your practice. Each one of you can take screenshot of these three scenarios. I have the scenario one up over here, and I'll move to scenario two and scenario three. The ask here is that if you can pick any of these three emails and write an email back to me on my mailbox, I'll give you the email ID at the end of the session. The best email which me and Om will go through, we'll assess the email based on today's session. Whatever we feel is the best one, we'll get some swags and probably certification vouchers as well. Okay, so your opportunity to win some swags and a voucher. So this is the first scenario, very simple one. This applies for all the people out here, including freshers, including students. This is very basic scenario, okay? I would expect freshers or students to get this email, not the experienced folks. You have better scenarios coming up in slide two and slide three. Okay, I hope everyone has taken a note of it. I'm moving on to the next one. Scenario two, where a colleague is working with you on a tight project and has to go on an emergency leave. You are now short by one resource in the project and you are unable to meet your deadlines. You need to ask your manager for an extension on the project timeline so that you can complete your work and you will not be able to meet the deadlines. Now, this is for experienced folks who are like more than 1 year of experience within Salesforce ecosystem. And there are few guidelines while writing your emails. Explain the scenario on who has gone on leave so that your manager is aware why are you asking for help. What steps have you taken up because someone is absent or someone is not going to be there? How can you backfill that person's role and how the other team members can step up or ensure that the delivery happens with whatever work was assigned to that person is taken over by someone else. So you as a team lead or you as a developer on the project, how will you think about that entire scenario? And lastly, why do you need that help, right? Explain your need for it and what will happen if the manager doesn't give you that extended timeline, right? So what are the implications of this is what you need to describe, okay? So good amount of hints over here, and I'm hoping that you guys can write this email and share it with me. Next scenario, moving on, is again, you need a guidance to work on a new tool which you have never worked on and you don't know. For example, you can have your own examples and you can write your own examples when drafting that email. But if you don't have one, you can use this example of Heroku to Salesforce integration. Person who knows the subject is busy with some another project and you need to send out an email to your manager asking for help. Okay, again, same instructions, set up the context because your manager might not be aware of what kind of requirement it is. What prep or research work you have done on your own before asking for help, right? It's normally a best practice that as developers, we first do our groundwork or homework before we reach out for help, right? That's what a good developer would always do or a good consultant would always do. Why do you need help and what are its implications if the demand is not met? So three very simple scenarios. Two and three is more for working professionals. First one was more for students and freshers if there are in this audience. right? And feel free to write whichever one you want and send it over. Okay, the email ID here is developer2consultant@gmail.com. It will come up in one of the slides later on, but just if you want to take a note of it, it's developer2consultant, two is a number, two, consultant@gmail.com. With that, we complete the email writing section of our talk today, and we'll move on to the verbal communication. Before I move to it, Seb, is there anything that you want to add from an email writing perspective?
Yes, Rupesh, so thank you very much for that. I kind of have two things that I would like to add. So first of all, when writing emails, the first question is, do you need that email? Because if you look into your inbox, there are so many emails out there, and very often it's just a repetition of information. So before you send out an email, or before you even start writing an email, ask yourself, is that really necessary? Am I adding any additional value, or is there existing information that already kind of proves my point that I'm trying to make, and I can just point towards that. And the second one is short and concise. It's nothing worse than an extremely long email that doesn't get the message across. So I've been facing that a tremendous amount of times when I was working with my clients. They'll be sending out emails back and forth, and you read like hundreds of lines, and there's zero information that you can actually extract from that. That would be my two cents on that.
Thank you, Seb. So these are very, very important and very critical when in your professional life. Only write emails where you can add a value. Do not write emails, long emails. Avoid them as long as possible. Unless where you want to explain everything on an email and you're not able to jump on a call with your intended audience, right? Always better to jump on a call and clarify your doubts rather than writing long emails and trying to clarify everything on an email. Thanks for that, Seb. And moving on to the next part of the conversation is around verbal communication. In any kind of verbal communication where you're talking, right, identify your role, what kind of role you're playing in that conversation, whether you are a listener or you are the person who is talking throughout the conversation, right? Even in your team meetings, what is your role? Do you have 5 minutes to talk versus are you only going to listen in that meeting, or are you going to manage that meeting right from the word go, right? So identify your role in any conversation, whether it is personal conversation, whether it is official meet, team meetings, or whether it is leadership conversations. Always ensure that you identify your role that you're going to play. Next, if you're going to talk, right, content is the king. What matters is not your fluent English or not big words or jazzy words. What are you going to talk? The real content is what is your message that matters the most in any kind of verbal communication, whether you are presenting to your team members within the office conference room, or whether you're presenting to a public audience like this, or whether you are on a stage like Dreamforce or TDX India, where you're presenting to a large group of people, right? Always ensure that you have a solid content which you're delivering, and work on that content. Unless you have a solid content, people will not get back to you to listen to you the next time you have a speaking opportunity, right? So that's very, very important, content part. Engaging the audience. The art of speaking is something which gets developed over the years. It doesn't happen on day one. So start small by grabbing the speaking opportunities within your project team with the known people around you, right? You are more comfortable opening your heart out or opening your thoughts out with the people whom you know on a day-to-day basis, right? So take speaking opportunities within the project team first. Slowly and steadily, as you gain in confidence, you can step out and be a speaker in these local community group events, or once you have mastered the art of speaking, even I would not say mastered, right? But once you are fairly confident of going out there and talking to a large audience, you'll make that gradual progress from being a shy or an introvert person to now a person who is fairly confident, who knows its content, what to speak, how to engage your audience, right? How to keep the audience levels up, right? Those are small tips and tricks which you will gather as you start speaking on a day-to-day basis. Address the subject, why this audience has come to me to listen to me, right? Today, why are you guys here? If I'm talking anything outside the communication skill set, you will not be interested in listening to, right? So addressing the subject, why the session was set up for, is very key and very, very important. And ensure that you make your statements to the point rather than trying to add a lot of additional content which is not relevant to that topic, right? Be clear, be concise, be straight to the point, and whatever you're saying, say it with conviction, right? And that conviction comes with confidence, with knowing your subject. If you have been asked to speak about, let's say, Heroku, you'll not be that confident because you don't know that subject, right? Some of you might know if you have gone through the trainings and if you have worked on Heroku, but if you have not worked on something, if you have not learned about something, you will not be that confident about speaking on that topic versus on a topic which you have been, let's say you're good at coding, right? And if you have been asked to explain the order of execution or how to write triggers, right? You will be fluent in talking about that topic. So whenever you're talking, ensure you have the right content, you're speaking with confidence and a lot of conviction so that the audience can listen to you. So these are some of the areas which I could think of which matters the most in a verbal communication. And next we'll look into different scenarios in which you will end up talking. So the first and foremost one, before we get into the scenarios, let's look at some more challenges which I have observed in project team meetings throughout my experience. Okay. When somebody is talking in a project setup or in a team setup, we tend to go silent. We think that silence is our best defense. If we speak, people will try to judge us. People will put us on spot. Or if there is a topic going on and if I put in my point of view, an action item will be assigned to me and I will be put to work, right? So we tend to go silent about it. We do not contribute at all in those team meetings and we be there or participate there only in a listen mode. The next common challenge which I've seen primarily from people who have got their schooling done in non-English mediums, right? Non-English schools, where you have a state dialect in your when you're trying to speak in English, right? There is some aspect of your state dialect or your mother tongue which comes along when you're trying to converse in English, right? Versus somebody who is very fluent in Hindi. If you have been speaking Hindi at home with your friends and colleagues at workplace, when you're trying to converse in English with your client directly, there's some aspect of it which will come along, right? Don't worry about it. As long as you are able to articulate your thoughts about the topic that you want to discuss with your audience, I think you should be good enough, right? Ensure that you're picking up simpler words to explain your thought process. Do not go for large sentences or big words to explain your thoughts. Keep it very simple. Keep it very clear on what you want to convey, okay? At the end of the day, if you're able to articulate or if you're able to convey your thoughts to someone, that is what matters, not your fluent English. One more challenge which I've seen often with the project members is ability to say no to something, right? And as Asmit mentioned, a scenario where an architect has a point of view and a developer has a point of view, right? Most of the times the developer do not even raise their voice that I don't understand this and I don't follow your solution. I think this is the best solution, or I think this is a better solution, right? Unless you talk about it, you will never get to know the architect's point of view as well. Same goes when we are interacting with your onshore counterparts or with your client counterparts, right? Unless you talk or unless you discuss them about a problem, you will never get to know what the other person is thinking, right? And be assertive when you're talking. Do not bring aggression in your talks, okay? Talk with confidence, talk to the point, talk to the subject that you want to discuss, rather than being aggressive and saying, no, you are not understanding my point. This is how it should be. This is what I have learned till date. This is the only way forward. Do not take that approach in your conversation. Okay. Be assertive, but be with confidence, be with data points, stick to your subject and stick to the standard documentation which Salesforce provides if there is any area of contention. You would have often seen the next scenario here, and the next challenge here is uncomfortable in introducing yourself, right? If I ask all the team members over here right now on this meetup to introduce themselves, how many of you will feel uncomfortable in doing it, right? Most of us, unless you have practiced that day in, day out, you reach to a point where you can directly walk into any place, any event, any conference, and you can introduce yourself without any fear to any random person walking out there, right? You have to develop that confidence by talking to yourself, probably in mirror to start with, and then developing this habit of introducing yourself in a more confident way in your project team meetings, in your leadership conversations, because these are the folks with whom you interact on a day-to-day basis. These are the people who know you as a person, right? So don't feel shy and bring out yourself in front of people who are there with you on a day-to-day basis. Oftentimes the confidence level is low because we are not sure about what to talk, right? What is the topic or what is the content that I should talk about? Unless you are a subject matter expert or unless you have a good understanding about the content, you will never feel confident about talking about it, right? So that's where we focus. One of the pillars of D2C is the knowledge. Gain as much as knowledge as you can around the Salesforce ecosystem, because that is what will make you more confident about speaking on any topic. And when you are in a consulting role, your client might come up with any project requirement on the go, right? Which might not be related to your entire project. They might be running into some issue which they have not even talked about to you. They are just introducing you to the first time, and you as a consultant would have to react to it or think about that problem statement right there, right? On the go. So my advice is always build up on your Salesforce knowledge as much as you can, so that you're able to handle all these unknown scenarios or ad hoc scenarios where you might be put up as a consultant. Conscious of what others would think, right? If I became conscious what you guys would be thinking about me right now, I would not be talking so much, right? I will be very selective in my words about what am I saying, how am I saying, because people are going to judge me on what am I trying to tell, right? Forget about the world when people start judging you about you on your language. If you are having good content, if you are able to communicate in clear and crisp words and a simplistic language, always do that. And as I said, conviction is always required, whether it's in your email writing, whether it is in your conversation. Always put your thought process with confidence with the right subject. With that, let's get into the scenarios where one-on-one discussions in your office space or in your when you're discussing someone with whom you trust, right? Whether it is a family member or whether it is a close relative or your team lead, whether you're working on a project for, let's say, for 1 year, 2 years, and you have built that trust over a period of time with that person, that you can open up about yourself, your problems, your personal challenges, your project challenges, your career growth, anything about yourself with that person, right? And my advice is that before you, for the initial few years when you're starting off as a professional, right, have more one-on-one discussions rather than writing emails. You will pick up on your email writing skills once you have done few implementations, once you have done few projects, you will catch up on your email writing skills. But ensure that you always keep up this habit of having one-on-one conversations on a regular basis so that you can get regular feedback from the people whom you trust, from your mentors, from your team leads, so that you can work upon it. Okay, and don't make it as a ritual to do it only when your annual appraisals are going to happen, right? I see team members coming up and asking for a one-on-one discussion only when there is a performance year coming or the salary is going to be discussed, let's say next month. So I'll go and ask for my feedback. How am I doing on the project? No, do it on a regular basis with a cadence so that you get your feedbacks on a regular basis and you can improvise as a professional. Next up is the daily team meetings. If you are in a team meeting where only one person is speaking, you are in a wrong meeting. Okay, very clear and very loud. A team meeting is supposed to be, or a scrum call is supposed to be with all the team members actively participating in it. Yes, the scrum master has to manage that call, but every team member has to speak for their own work. If there is a schedule or a habit within the team meetings that one person takes a roll call and provides updates on behalf of everyone else, probably you are not required in that meeting, right? That person who is speaking can very well conduct that meeting and take your thoughts and present on behalf of you in that meeting. You can utilize or you can make a productive use of that half an hour or 1 hour on something else where you can learn and grow, right? So that's my thought process again. However, there will be instances where, let's say, if a leadership calls for a big meeting, even though if you don't have to contribute, but you have to be there as a listen mode, right? But here I'm talking majorly about project scrum calls, which happens on a day-to-day basis, where I personally believe every team member should speak up for their own task and not let just one person speak all the time. If you are in a meeting where your contribution is, let's say, just announce yourself saying hi, everyone, and then at the end of the call, just saying bye, avoid those kind of meetings. Multitasking while on meetings, right? If we are in such meetings where we are forced to be there and we are not interested in the subject or not interested in the content that is being delivered, we will end up doing something else. So right now, if people are not connected to me, what I'm talking, you would have been doing, writing those emails which you want to submit by 7 p.m. or you would have been having a nice cup of coffee or playing with your kids while you are on mute, right? Avoid this multitasking when you're in your, in a, this is fine. I mean, in a community meetups is fine, but when you're in, you are in your office meetings, project meetings, avoid multitasking while you're in an important meetings. Again, not sure about what to talk, as I said, right? If you're not clear about the subject or the content, you will have low confidence on while speaking on any subject. And conscious of being judged. It happens every time on any meeting. Even today, it happens with me if I'm getting into a leadership discussion with the directors, with the partners from the company. I will always be conscious of what I'm going to say. How am I going to say? Is my presentation right? Whether it will impact on me, on my performance, so and so forth, right? There are a lot of thoughts that goes into your mind while you prepare for a meeting. And with that, I'll take the leadership meetings as well. When you are entering a leadership meeting, when I say leadership meeting, managers and above, if you're getting into a meeting with managers and above kind of cadre, always ask for an agenda. What are you going to go there and discuss, right? If there is an agenda, read through it and be well versed with it. If you don't have one, ask for it. There is no harm in asking for an agenda. There are often myths that if I ask for an agenda with a manager or a director, the person will feel bad about it and will take offense about a junior person coming and asking for an agenda. At times, from a leadership standpoint, if they are busy in so many other things, right, they might not even have time to clearly describe the agenda and they want you in the meeting, right? But if you have the time and be matured as a professional, take it very contextual based on the situation. If you have the time and if you feel the need of having an agenda, ask for it. Again, understand your audience. Who all are there in that leadership meeting? Whether it is your one team, your own project team, or whether it is hundreds of other teams, right? A leader might be managing more than one project. Is it a multi-team environment or is it a single team environment? Based on the audience, be aware of the fact of what you're going to convey and what how are you going to say. Be well prepared. If you had an action item from your previous meeting, always ensure that you are going into that meeting with proper status updates on your action items. If you have been asked a question in a meeting, or if you've been asked to talk on a subject which you are not sure of, okay, always buy time rather than responding ad hocly, unsure about what you're talking, right? Do not try to respond immediately. Okay, always buy in time when you're not sure about the subject. Okay, and don't make if the subject is obvious, if it is related to your day-to-day project work, then don't say, okay, I need more time to think and come back on it. Okay, only if the subject is not known to you, if it is outside your project work or the day-to-day work that you're doing, that's where you can ask for more time. Okay, and any leader with whom you work, right, will always look for a team member who can take ownership and who can deliver the work responsibly. Okay, you will also find this when you grow into a leadership position, when you become a manager or a senior manager on any company, you will always like people or like to work with people who can take ownership of the deliverable and who can deliver it on time. With that, the last aspect of verbal communication is also preparing this documentation or preparing text.
Yeah. Sorry for interrupting. Somebody asking what is leadership meeting? So I think something for him.
Yeah. Leadership. Okay. Leadership is basically if you're working in a company, right? Obviously, you work in a project team. Okay. And there are different designations given to the kind of role you will play in a company, right? So you begin with as a fresher, you will be given analyst or a developer role. As you gain experience, you will be given senior developer or a consultant role. As you move forward in your experience, you will be given a technical lead or a project lead role, right? As you move further up, you will be given a manager or an architect role. As you move further up the ladder, you will be given a senior manager or a engagement manager kind of a role, right? Anyone who is manager and above will fall under the leadership bracket, okay? And this group basically takes care of all your sales force as a practice, how the practice should grow, how do you get your new business within your company, how your development team gets new projects. All these additional work items are taken care by this leadership group. Okay. Seb, are you still there? I just saw your message that you need to drop off. But if you're still there, any thoughts you would like to share?
Yes, sorry, I just had to drop off of it for a couple of minutes because I needed to get something sorted here in the house.
Yeah.
So I think when it comes to presentations, and we all spend way too much time in meetings and presentations, I think then you need to really make sure that you have an outcome that you're working towards. You know, no matter if you want to clarify a requirement with the customer or if you want to present like different kinds of solution options, you need to have a clear idea what you want to get out of this meeting. Yeah, and having this outcome in your mind, you should structure it accordingly. So what you also said is here, really having a structure in the presentation, that structure should build up to your target. Yeah. And of course, modeling the message to your audience is extremely important. That would be probably the most important thing for me to say.
But thank you for your words. And it's really important for each one of us to understand more of it, as some of us might be on the architect journey as well, why presentations are so important. And thanks for your time today, Seb. It was really an honor to have you on this session. Thanks for sparing your weekend for us, and have a nice day.
Thank you.
Bye, Seb. Thank you for being with us. Take care.
Bye.
All right, so I'll just cover up. I think Seb clearly described it, what presentations are all about, right? So let's say next time you want to create a presentation deck, what are the key things that you should look at? When I was preparing this deck, which I went through to in today's session, right? I first started off with only my slide headers, okay? I created 30 slides and I went through the title of each of the slide and I put it on in a presentation mode and walk through all the 30 slides. Whether it is coming in a nice flow or not, the approach which I'm telling here is basically the storytelling. Whether the messaging that I want to convey in today's session is coming in a nicely story format or not, right? If you would have noticed in other presentations, the speaker introduction happens right at the front, right, on the first slide. But if you would have noticed in today's conversation, I introduced us as speakers, myself and Seb as speakers, after setting up the context for D2C, right? So I worked on the entire flow by just looking at the slide headers. And the slide headers, for example, this one here, right, presentation, it is similar to an email subject, right? By just looking at the subject, the audience should know what this slide is going to be all about, right? So whenever you're working on a presentation, work on your slide headers the first and go through your slide headers from one to the end slide and analyze it whether the entire storytelling is coming out nicely or not, okay? And if you're new to this entire presentation building exercise, then work with some of your project team members who have done it in the past, right? So work with your team lead, work with your project manager so that they can review and provide you comments on the entire presentation. And with practice, with experience, you will get a hang of it, okay? And more you present, more confident you will become. Now, some of the key areas which I normally try to analyze in all of my presentation is, what is the subject that I want to deliver, right? What is the intent of this slide? What is the overall objective that I want to achieve from this session? Why the audience should come and listen to me, right? There should be something out for the audience as well when they go back and sit back and reflect why I spent 2 hours listening to this guy, right? And there should be something meaningful that should come out. Who is your audience, right? So today when I'm addressing you guys, I'm ensuring that I'm addressing to students, freshers, and even the experienced professionals. So I know that my audience here is a mixed bag. I'm not just addressing to students. So if I have to deliver the same session only for students, I will probably not talk about some of the areas which are related only to working professionals, right? So understand your audience and tailor your messaging in your presentations accordingly. What problem are you going to solve, or how are you going to solve a problem? So this typically applies when you're responding to a proposal, when you're doing an RFP, right? This is primarily for pre-sales. Anybody who understands pre-sales world, or just to put it in a simple language, if your company is trying to get more business, a new project for your team, they have to basically work on a proposal document, right? And they have to go out and present it to the client why the client should select your company to work with on this project, right? So how are you going to solve their business problem? You need to elaborate in your slide deck as well. Where to look for additional help? So if the audience wants to understand more about this topic or more about this subject, where all they should go and look for additional information. So with that, I'll give you some additional links which you can go through and gain more on the communication skill set. The first two links are basically web articles which are available on internet, which you can go through, and most of these points which I've discussed today are referred from there. So you can have a detailed reading around these two links. The last four links are Trailhead badges, and Salesforce also have come up with real nice content around how do you prepare your Salesforce career. How do you align yourself? How do you do storytelling? How do you build up your communication skills? The one important one which I would like everyone to do, the Trailhead badge, is alignment with your manager. There are real nice examples, real nice nuances which are called out in this Trailhead badge, which basically gives you your office kind of a setup and talks about why it is important for your professional growth and your career growth that you should have your thoughts aligned with your manager. When I say thoughts aligned, not saying that unki haan mein haan milao, right? But ensuring that what are your personal and professional goals are well understood by your manager as well, right? Only when they understand your personal and professional goals, only then they will be able to help you in your career as well. Okay, with that, I wrap up the session for today. If there are any feedback, right, you can write to me on this email address. And this is the email address where you need to submit your emails as well. developer2consultant@gmail.com. You can also reach out to me on my Twitter handle @RupeshBhatia85. And there is this bit.ly URL, which is a Google form where I would like to hear more from you about today's session. If there are any other area which you want me to cover in my future workshops, I would be happy to know about that. And if there are any additional content which you would like me to cover, let me know. Okay. If there are any project, if there are any specific scenarios you want me to cover in my future workshops, you can add those as comments as well. And in general, if there is any other feedback, whether this session was good, bad, I'm open to all kind of comments. Okay. If there is anything negative, please feel free to share, because that will help me improvise on my next sessions. And I'll ensure that I won't repeat some of those mistakes. And if there's anything good about it, feel free to add that as well, so that I can put it out on social channels, so that people who have not attended this session will ensure that, or will make an effort to attend these sessions so that they can benefit out of it. Okay. With that, I'll hand it over to Om, and if there are any questions you have, I'm here to answer them.
Thank you, Rupesh. Thank you very much for having with me. So guys, if any question, please unmute yourself and please ask. Rupesh will answer all those questions. And Vikram, I'm not getting, can you please rephrase the question once? And yeah, anyone, please come and make this interactive with asking questions, which will be helpful for you and others as well.
Hey, Rupesh, thank you for your session. This is Vikram from Pune team. Actually, you have shown some links, right? That will be kind of helpful for understanding the concepts. I think the last second slide. Could you please share the link on the chat, because we won't be able to copy that one, right?
This one, the feedback one, or
no, the earlier one.
These ones.
Yeah. Those references.
Okay, got it. Great.
Okay. Let.
Hello, sir. Good evening.
Yes.
Sir, your English is amazing. I want to talk like you without breaks. Any tips, sir?
So, I mean, in terms of talking in English, right? As I said, don't aim for fluent talks, right? For you, it will be important that if you're able to articulate your thoughts. Okay, if you would have observed, I don't consider myself as a very good English speaker. There are a lot of areas which I can improve from today's session as well. There were a lot of repetitive messaging that I did, right? But then I think talking in fluent English will only come if you practice a lot, right? So luckily for me, I was from an English medium school, but then I've seen these challenges with mostly with vernacular medium schools, right? Where you don't have this habit of talking in English. Okay. Even in my childhood, I never used to talk in English with any of my school classmates, though I was in an English medium school, right? But then over the years, I made it a point that when I entered into my professional life, even if I'm talking to any of my colleagues or peers over a coffee break or in a lunch break, I do not converse with them in Hindi or in any of the other languages. I always converse with them on English. Okay. So make that as a habit on your day-to-day project work with your colleagues, with your friends. Try to converse with them more in English so that you can gain practice on it. And in terms of improving your vocabulary, I would suggest reading more books or more newspapers so that you can improvise on grammatical areas and pronunciations and all those nitty-gritties, right? But I think practice is the key over here, and it will come with practice. So practice a lot, talk with more people, and read more. Whether it is web articles, newspapers, or books.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir.
Hi, Rupesh, sir. I have a query.
Yep.
Basically, if I write like an email to a management and not getting any response frequently after two or three emails, then what should be the next step I have to do?
So you're writing an email to whom?
Office, in the office organization, to the management or any other person.
Okay. So if you're so it depends, right? Whom are you writing to? If you're writing to your manager, if you're not getting a response, probably there are couple of reasons. One is your manager is ignoring your email because he or she is very busy with their work, right?
Okay.
Then the best option for you is to ping them on Skype or IM and ask them for their time, right? Because your emails, the person is not able to read, right? And get into a one-on-one conversation because email is not going to work over here. If it is for any other team member who is not responding to your emails, and again, best option is to have the one-on-one conversation and ask them for their time. If the person is still ignoring your meeting request as well, then send a reminder again, but this time ensure you keep your manager or your team lead in CC so that they can take a notice of it that this person is ignoring you and not responding to your emails, despite you attempting or you reminding them a couple of times, asking for meeting request, whatever it is, right? So that your management can chime in and basically bridge the gap between you and that person, right? And go by the hierarchy. That's what I normally advise. Do not keep managers in every emails. First, keep your team lead in CC. If you are the team lead, then yes, you can keep your managers. If you are the manager, then yes, you can keep your senior manager. The idea is always keep your immediate next level in the loop if you're not getting your timely responses.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I have a question. In which situation I can actually skip the hierarchy of asking the question and directly go to the manager of our manager?
Yeah, so if it is something about the manager itself, right, which you want to talk with his or her superior, right, which you cannot talk directly to your manager, right? If it is anything related to the project, yes, the go-to person should be your manager. But if it is anything with respect to the manager himself or herself, right, whether you have a problem with that person himself or herself, and you cannot, my advice would be that you can still make an attempt to talk to them, right? If the person is receptive, if the person is a good leader, they will always make time for someone to listen. Even if it is a negative feedback, I will always make a time to someone within my team who wants to talk to me, right? If you have tried doing that and if you're still not able to convey your message, right, and if you have made attempts, always ensure that when you're making those attempts, it is documented. When I say documented, at least you should send out meeting invites, set up some time, and if the person doesn't join the meeting, then you have a proof that you had set up a meeting. You should write emails to that person clarifying your thought process or putting out your point of view so that you have that as documented as well. Because when you skip the hierarchy and go to the next level, right, obvious questions that will come up front is why this person directly reached out to me versus their immediate superiors, right? And then there will be investigation on what you have to say, whether it is a complaint or an escalation. And if the senior managers wants to address that, they will basically go to the root cause of it. Why you had to raise this to them directly? Why cannot it be done directly to your superiors? You can always provide your emails or meeting invites as a data proof that you tried doing that and the person was not receptive enough. This happens in a very rare scenario, 1%, I would say. 99% of the cases, managers are receptive enough. There will hardly be anyone who would say a complete no to your meeting request or your emails. So yeah, if you have to take that extreme case, you can, but ensure that you are keeping yourself safeguarded by having those data points with you by a documented email or a meeting invite in first place. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you.